Ladies and gentlemen, in-betweeners and our dearly departed, I am your hostess with the mostest, Alexander, here for On the Rocks, every Tuesday where celebrities and cocktails mix, and tonight we have the spirits, get it? We're high spirits tonight, a little puff puff, a little sip sip, we got everything going. We have the stars of Ghost Brothers, Dalen, Juwan, and Marcus are in studio with my special guest co-host. Returning to the show is paranormal investigator and psychic Shana Leilani and actor Michael Vega. Let the spirits begin. I'm ready.
And most poor suckers are starving to death.
I'd like to propose a toast.
This is On the Rocks with Alexander, coming at you from Sunset Gower Studios in the heart of Hollywood, where I drink with your favorite celebrities and we talk about fashion, entertainment, pop culture, reality TV, and that's about it. So pop a cork, pour a glass, lean back, and enjoy On the Rocks every Tuesday at 7 p.m. on Universal Broadcasting Network.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that. It is going to be a bumpy night. We are talking about things that go bump in the night. I'm so excited for today's show. Hello to our listeners around the nation on iHeartRadio, REVRY, Universal Broadcasting Network, Player FM, Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn, Satchel, iTunes, and of course we are streaming on Facebook Live, on the Rocks Facebook page and Hillcrest Social, and of course on True FM in Ohio. Who knew, Ohio? I'm coming at you for Columbus Pride at the end of July, so be ready. Tonight's show, I'm very excited, is brought to you by Taste On Ellis. It's a restaurant located near Union Square in San Francisco at Hotel Fusion. And in Hotel Fusion is the hottest nightclub in San Francisco. It's called Infusion Lounge, and it's super, super hot. In fact, I'm heading out there this next weekend. They are giving a gift to On the Rocks that I'm giving to my listeners. They're giving a weekend getaway. It's a weekend for two at Hotel Fusion with a pair of Giants tickets. Giants, I think it has something to do with baseball, maybe. Something like that. It's sports. It's sports related. Hop off, hop on passes, which is, I guess, a thing in San Francisco. I'm sure it is. It's for two.
That's why they're number one ranked, baby. That's why they're number one ranked.
Clang, clang, clang with the trolley. They also give you trolley tickets, and what really tops it off is that Saturday night that you get there, they are giving you VIP champagne bottle service at Infusion Lounge, and you get free breakfast while you're there, so hangover breakfast, you get it. So this is a great giveaway. There's nothing you have to do except go to tasteonellis.com, which is the restaurant there. Go to contact, type in On the Rocks, and you're entered to win. They are picking the winner on April 1st, and I'm probably going to be there when you go there. So get ready. So that is our gift. Tony, thank you so much for running the boards today. Kurt's gone somewhere.
So no pun?
No pun today. In fact, he doesn't have his own little like microphone. But Tony, you have a paranormal type show here on Fridays.
Yes, I do.
What's it called? Truth Be Told. That's a great title. I wish I thought about that. But it deals with all things paranormal. I can only handle it once in a while. You do this like weekly. But like when I do paranormal stuff, like I watched Conjuring through a sheet. Like I paid full price for the movie. And I have like a sheet here that I have to watch it through.
You brought the sheet with you? You brought the sheet to the...
Honey, it's West Hollywood. You come prepared for anything. You know what I mean?
Yeah, okay. That's like some
PR ready stuff. To be ready.
I got you.
Yeah. Marcus has already given, like, so he's bringing the diva, the shade, the whole
thing. Let's go. Yes. Let's go. If we're going to be here, let's be here.
Hey. I like a little
get chapeau. Your mind together, Dalen.
Whoa.
Uh-oh.
Wow.
calling him out early.
It's like having the show, like, right here, because we do have the show, now celebrating season two on TLC. As always, Mama Rose is in the chat room. She's answering your questions. She has watched Ghost Brothers. She has done her research, so she's answering your questions. If it's a hot burning question, she'll interrupt the show and ask us. Coming up real fast, Overboard is here. It's Long Beach Pride. It's the Pride Party on the Queen Mary. And it's Saturday, May 20th, and I will be hosting. I'll be live streaming. Go to overboardlbc.com to get your tickets. Or if you want a free VIP boarding pass, email info@ontherocksradioshow.com. Just type in Overboard, and we'll throw a VIP boarding pass your way. Now let's get to it. Boo. That was my gay ghost. Boo.
Okay. I thought it'd be like more like boo. Boo. Boo.
No, that's my mom. Okay. She's like, when I'm not air. Answering, that's what she's saying. No, this is boo.
Boo. Okay, gotcha.
It's like a low energy gay ghost. That's like Liberace after a few. He's like, I'm done. Shana, I want to catch up. You know, every time we do anything paranormal or psychic, of course you're the one that I bring in. You are so fun. And you've got this whole like this whole fun life. Not only are you a paranormal investigator, you're a psychic, but you do burlesque and all this kind of stuff.
Because there's nothing more liberating than telling fortunes, hunting dead people, and getting naked. Sometimes all
that's
the
like a Sunday
time.
Afternoon for me.
Wow.
You're gonna do that on Sunday?
Wow, hallelujah!
After church,
the Lord. Look at the Lord.
Right after church.
Oh, you're being modest.
Yes. What is your Instagram handle? Because our listeners have to follow you because they get a little bit of everything. They get to see pictures of Ouija boards. They get to see pictures of haunted dolls. In fact, you brought Stephanie back.
I did. I brought your best friend Stephanie back. You still have not poured her a drink. She is kind of having some issues.
Can she have a sip? No, literally, this doll is haunted. It has a presence. Tell us what the story is behind Stephanie.
So I think the last time the last time I brought her here, she actually turned the lights off in the middle of the show.
We were filming, and the lights like went out.
Yeah, but
bad girl.
She got up and turned them off.
No, with her mind.
Oh, okay.
Telekinesis, Marcus.
Okay,
hello.
I'm just checking. I'm like, I didn't know she got up.
Maybe you should watch your own show. It can happen without them doing anything.
She got up and just turned the light off.
She was giving last call. They say the freaks come out when the lights go out.
That's what happens when it's last call for me at a bar. I just go knocking out all the lights.
This okay. is why you and Stephanie are friends. There you go. You're learning from her. So Stephanie is a haunted doll. The spirit attached to her is a middle-aged woman that was severely autistic.
Oh.
And she wasn't treated very well by her family in life. And so the only thing that she had of comfort was this handmade doll that was made for her from one of her family members, who is Stephanie and who she is since attached to. I have friends that own a vintage store, so they called me. They're having a lot of problems and things were getting really disruptive, and we figured out it was this doll. And I actually figured out she just wanted friends. That's all it
was.
Well,
she's got him here.
I've come and I've introduced her to you, and now she messes with you, and you give her drinks. She turns off your lights. There you go.
Well, Stephanie, you have a wide range of listeners now and friends. Thanks for coming in. I'm like scared.
Your hair looks great.
Right.
So what is your daily routine? Because I know you mix a lot. You know, you're married, you're friends. How psychic filled is your day?
Gosh. Well, that is actually my 9-to-5 job. So it really does take.
Do you have to clock
really
in?
Sometimes.
Don't they just know? I'm at work.
I'm the resident psychic here, so I'm the one that guesses when my paycheck comes.
Yeah. Every 2 weeks, according to ADP.
There we go. So that is my 9-to-5. So I kind of have like the normal life in the morning where I'm like prepping the husband for work, taking care of the dogs and stuff like that.
Prepping the husband for work, like packing his lunch and dressing him.
What goes on in prep? Yeah.
Or more so, telling him what's going to happen that day. Yeah. Tell him what's going to happen that day.
Making coffee, lunches. Like I have that really boring domestic housewife thing to me. I really do. Like I make casseroles and meatloaf.
Love meatloaf.
It's not boring at all.
Of course, she does
not boring at all.
She does it. She does it topless or with like 1920s pasties.
So that makes it even livelier.
Yeah, she's
exactly.
More exciting. Yeah,
that's where the meatloaf is. Oh, get that meatloaf ready, baby. Okay. Go ahead and make that meatloaf.
Give me some gravy.
That's at night.
Okay. I promise, Alexander, I will have a picture on Instagram next week of me making meatloaf in pasties now. It's going to happen.
Right. You said your Instagram was what?
Intuitive Shana. You guys
just,
better follow
just
me.
Just forward that to me. That yeah. Don't tag me.
All right. Your wife might be watching.
Yeah, my wife is watching.
So after I'm done with the husband and the work and everything like that, I actually kind of go more into my paranormal stuff, more into a lot of burlesque practice and everything that goes on in between that. A lot of times it does fall together because we've had a residency at a haunted bar this entire time. So it really did kind of go hand in hand for me. Everything kind of blended into one.
Now, when you get ready to do a reading, like what's your process? Do you set up the appointments? Do they just walk in?
Both, a little bit of both. So I do work at a store called the Green Man Store, so you can actually book me there, and I do have somebody that takes care of all that for me just because I'm lazy. It's not that I'm professional. I'm just really lazy.
At least you're honest. Yeah. That's your skill on your resume.
Yes,
I'm a lazy psychic.
Oh, yeah. Very.
Tell me or don't tell me. It's fine.
You might do something nice tomorrow, yeah. But you might not. I don't really know.
Is there someone in the room? I don't care. Yeah.
Probably. But I prep the room, and I spiritually prep it and stuff like that, make sure it's cleansed, and I get ready. And during my readings, I actually connect with the people's chakras as well as their spirit guides who like to kind of chime in and lecture them right from the get-go, and then we get into questions that they have. And a lot of times I recommend different magical things like baths and candles and stuff like that from
I hope everybody's taking a bath. Yeah.
You know, with a little bit of witchcraft, a little extra oomph.
Oh. Okay.
That's how we're supposed to be taking a bath.
That sound like that burns.
Yeah. Like there's gonna be a steak involved.
Tell me all about the oomph.
That's another meatloaf.
That's another meatloaf.
I feel like meatloaf is our safe word.
Meatloaf, meatloaf, meatloaf.
You're gonna need one with me. You're gonna need a safe one. Meatloaf. All right, there we go.
It's meatloaf.
50 Shades of Hay. Meatloaf.
Boo.
Now, what happens when somebody sits down and you just don't like them?
Well, you know, it happens. It happens. I try and pride myself on my acting skills, eh? You know what? There is times, though, in all honesty, where you just don't connect with somebody, and it does happen, and usually you can kind of figure that out within the first, like, 3 to 5 minutes, in which case I'm not going to try and, like, pull teeth and figure out how to make it work. I just send them to a different reader. Luckily, there's a lot of really talented people at my work, so I can kind of send them in a better direction, but it rarely happens.
Now, how tired are you at the end of the day? Like, if I had to read and then, like, the paranormal stuff, and we'll ask this from the Ghost Brothers, too, is, like, it's not just, like, doing a job, especially, like, you guys have to experience all this paranormal stuff and then have to do it on camera. Be mindful that you're still selling the show. You have to have little bits that you do and all that kind of stuff. Like, how exhausted are you?
Well, I do live mostly off coffee. I'm pretty sure I have more coffee than blood in my veins, so it helps. It really does. No, it is something that can be very draining, but, you know, the work I do is really rewarding. I really get to help people, whether it's through readings or healings or whatever it is, to help them achieve some peace and happiness in their life. So even though I'm tired and drained, there is that helps kind of put that pep in your step and help you keep going. That, and again, coffee.
So her blood type is latte.
Coffee, yes, latte. Exactly.
Has anyone ever come up like blank? Like, it really, really hard to read. It's just like...
Yeah, well, when that happens, a lot of times it's because they're a little skeptical of what's going on, which I totally get. So I kind of have to stop and sit them down and talk and be like, listen, I don't play Stump the Psychic. So if we're going to play that, I'm going to send you to someone else.
Yeah.
But a lot of time after I talk to them and we kind of connect a little bit, if I can just find one thing to kind of like reach and grab onto, they tend to go, oh, okay, I don't have to be so afraid. I don't have to be so guarded when I tell them I'm not going to like tell them when they're going to die and stuff like that. It's more like giving them advice on what they need to do. They tend to relax. So usually that blankness is just like fear.
I always think it's lack of personality.
I mean, sometimes.
I've always had this like question for a psychic. So you don't get the numbers ever.
If I did, I wouldn't be here, dude.
Dang it. I'm trying to make a little appointment, but like...
Yeah. We'd have a psychic as our president. You know?
Oh, my gosh.
Meatloaf.
So many ways.
Meatloaf.
Meatloaf.
My other guest co-host today is Michael Vega, returning to the show. Actor. I have to... Recently, there's a painting based on one of your acting. I have to play this picture of you in the craziest... that's the painting. Okay. Don't give it away, Tony. So here's your actual role. So you're like a transvestite nurse?
I am a transvestite nurse. She's kind of psychotic. And yeah, and there she's just...
Not much preparation there for you.
Well, I had to prepare to wear a neoprene dress for 3 hours.
Again, like you didn't have it in your closet. along with Marcus's hat. It was like an ensemble that came together. It was like all about that.
It wasn't as low cut.
But based on this performance, I know you got a lot of great reviews. There's a painting that's crazy to me.
There's a great portrait artist who a friend of mine owns a gallery art house in San Francisco, and he said, you should get a portrait done. But he didn't suggest this particular picture. And normally he just does, you know, a handsome picture or whatever. And I said, no, I want it to mean something. I want to see it on my wall. I want to laugh. So I said, let's do this. And so, yeah, so it's painting, and there's, like, silver leaf in the back, and I think he captured the moment. he captured the crazy eyes.
And now it's your Grindr profile picture, which is which is
it's working. It's working.
Is it?
I was going to ask.
How successful is it?
Right.
Well, it's a step up from your other one. It was like finding Bigfoot. Found it.
Meatloaf.
That's on Scruff.
Meatloaf.
Meatloaf.
Mom. Meatloaf.
Meatloaf. Where's the meatloaf, Mom?
Bell. It's like a whole routine.
But
like
I got a lot of gravy.
Oh, there it is.
Super callback.
Inappropriate. Woo! This is a way family show.
Super callback.
Cheers.
Now, Michael, you, like myself, coming from a very Latino culture, religious background, I know you've had some paranormal experiences. How do you work in religion with that?
I try not to.
Well, Jesus is mad at you. He's seen your lifestyle. He's like, He's like, I'm not coming back for a while, everybody.
I know you, boss. I know you. Right. Do your thing. That's what he says. It's all good. Do your thing. I love you too, baby. Come on. Do your thing. Go ahead, be the nurse.
I have no explanation for it. So, I mean, I know there's something out there, but I tend not to define it. And I'll tell you, a supernatural you know, the films, anything that's ever happened to me freaks me the heck out.
So like what is a story that like sticks out in your mind?
I lived in Tucson, Arizona for about a year, many years ago. Longest year of my life, but hi to folks in Tucson. But we lived in a house where there was one bedroom that I would occasionally sleep in if I got home late from work. And this bedroom was always much colder than every other bedroom. Mm. And we noticed a little bit later that there was obviously locks on the outside of the door. Mm. You can obviously tell that this door had been
pushed,
you know,
over.
Yeah, there was like stress in the wood, and there were definitely locks. And if I was sleeping, I would feel somebody sitting at the edge of the bed. I never felt anything more than that. Wow. But it was always much cold. And we're in Tucson, Arizona, where it's like 150 degrees in the
all
shade.
The time.
And it was yeah, exactly.
It's set on the
and
same.
Then this room was that's why I slept in it, because it was just so comfortably cold. But then I'd be sleeping for a few hours, and then I'd feel.
You know that's the ghost's room, though, right? That's probably why
something
like,
probably big
cool
happened
in here
there.
To me. Like I like it cool in here too. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Like,
oh, exactly.
And at least somebody was in your bed.
Wow.
Drew here. Drew Hill in this thing.
We weren't supposed to talk about that.
You have some like local Los Angeles stories for us. Before we get into the ghost brothers.
Hey, that's
the A on it.
Brothers.
That's me trying to be cool. Right. Did you see that? It works out really well.
It works
out.
Oh, he's hip.
Right. So yeah, I do. I have some really cool stuff to talk about in Los Angeles. A lot of times when we hear about haunted places, I always feel like they're so far away, out of state, and it kind of makes me sad because I want to go talk to dead people. But
it's true. Other paranormal shows, like you guys are always out there. It's like... just comment.
People
like,
died in L.A. too.
Everywhere.
There's
today.
A lot of people. Today.
Yes.
Somebody
right
just
now.
Died.
Yeah.
Right now.
Somebody
I just saw that happen.
Right on point.
I just saw that happen while I was coming in the office.
Right on
point. Okay, excuse me. I got to get to this radio show. Excuse me.
You'll come back and talk to
we'll come
later.
Back and talk to you later.
I'll see you later.
I'll
really
back.
Means you'll see him later.
I'll be back.
So the first place I want to talk about, mostly because I'm very food motivated, is Sweet Lady Jane's, which is right in West Hollywood off Melrose, right?
Right. It's on Melrose, and you guys, we have pictures of it. It's the cutest little boutique place, and I'm telling you, everybody goes there. The pastries are unbelievable, and you'll see Hollywood celebrities there next to homeless people there. I mean, they'll save up their coins to get this. It's so good. It's so good.
Hey, baby, let me get about 15 cents. Yes. I got to get this scoodle.
Well, no, it's probably $15 for like a donut hole. It's a little expensive.
Well, homeless people always ask, piece by piece. They never ask for you. For
they have better
15.
iPhones than I do. I'm telling you. I don't know.
They got
the LA homeless or
they got square caps now. You know the square.
Yep, there you go.
I slide that right through, baby. Right
I don't have any cash. No problem.
You can Venmo me. You can Venmo me. I got that too, baby. Homeless man one.
We're so inappropriate right now. Our apologies to homeless people. Okay.
They're not listening.
Yes.
They're not
listening.
Or on their iPhone.
Yes, on their iPhone. Yes, they have the UBN radio app. It's quite popular.
So Sweet Lady Jane's is actually supposed to be haunted from Orson Welles.
Well, if anybody was going to eat a pastry, it was Orson Welles.
That's why he's still there.
Yes. Basically. Yeah. So this place used to be called Mamasan back in the day, and Orson Welles ate there for lunch and dinner almost every single day for the last few years of his life. And
I didn't
know
that.
So it was really common to find him hanging out there eating. And it was actually this little tiny little place that only had one table inside, which was his table. So you would always see him there, and that was just his spot. No one else got to touch it. Everyone else that wanted to eat ate outside on the patio. Mm-hmm. So it has since, as the whole block was renovated, they actually tore the building down, and then when they rebuilt it, they moved it up closer to the curb. So the original building where Orson Welles would hang out was actually a little bit further away from the curb, but now we have Sweet Lady Jane's there, which, again, amazing pastries. So if you want to go talk to dead people and eat yummy things, that is where you do it. I've done it many times, like late night automatic writing sessions. That's where you go.
Interesting.
What kind of claims do they have there?
So when some of the claims are started with the employees and then the patrons, probably after the patrons caught wind of who supposedly haunted there, was that they would see him sitting at his table, even though it wasn't until relatively recently that people discovered that his table was a few feet back from where it is today. They would see an obese man sitting there writing, eating, that kind of stuff, and then he'd just kind of fade away. The other thing that is more so reported a lot of the times is the scent of cigar smoke, because he was a smoker. He did smoke his cigars inside, and so people people still today, over like the smell of the sugar and everything else, they'll smell his cigar smoke in the bakery. Mm.
Have you brought Stephanie with you there?
No, but you know what? I think she's kind of hungry and we might go there afterwards. I'm thinking about it. Maybe she'll make a new friend.
Right, right.
So Marcus, I love how you got like in paranormal where you're like, any claims there? Like you got
I can move it back and forth.
On point, sir. Yeah.
I like it. I like it. So the next, so that one's kind of just like an easy, not necessarily, I mean, I guess no haunting is like a feel good story, but it's pretty cool. Like you go, you get yummy things, smell cigar smoke, whatever. It's cool. The next one actually is a little bit more tragic. I wanted to talk about the Hollywood sign. It's so
it's iconic. You can see it from Sunset Gower Studios. Yeah. Yep.
You can see it everywhere. And it's just like this beacon of hope for starlets thinking about coming here from everywhere. They think of that Hollywood sign. They don't think about the tragedy and the other things that have taken place there. So this actually happened in the 30s when the Hollywood sign was still the Hollywood Land sign, which was put
there.
Which
we have a picture, yep.
Yeah, so it was called Hollywood Land. It was actually kind of put there as a ploy to get people to buy property here.
It was like track homes that they were trying to sell.
Yeah, and they were trying to sell it, so they put this sign up, which is today turned into the classic Hollywood sign. So there was an actress named Peg Entwistle, whose real name was Millicent Lillian Entwistle, and she actually committed suicide on the Hollywood sign in September of 1932. She was originally from, I believe, Wales, and she made it big in New York on Broadway, and this was right when Hollywood was transitioning from silent films to speaking roles, which a lot of actors just weren't cut out for the speaking roles.
Because their voices were very high.
Yeah.
What's up with that?
So she was like, hey, I can talk. I'm in theater. Like, let's do it. So she came here, ran into a crap marriage, everything else. She got cast for one movie where she was supposed to be a pretty strong supporting role, which was then cut. And so she basically had a cameo, which was just really heartbreaking to her. So as it went and she was just getting denied from all of her auditions, she just couldn't deal with it anymore. So she told her uncle, who she was living with, that she was going to go meet up with some friends. And she hiked all the way up to the Hollywood sign, climbed up to the H, and threw herself off of it.
Oh, wow.
And she was found the next day by a hiker who found one shoe, a jacket, and her suicide note, which was really sad. Her suicide note actually read, I am afraid. I am a coward. I am sorry for everything. If I had done this a long time ago, it would have saved a lot of pain. P.E. So she didn't even sign her real name. So it took 2 days for her uncle to connect the dots about hearing this to report that it was her. The Damn. Most ironic part about all of this was those 2 days later when her uncle figured out that it was her, he also happened to open her mail that she did get cast in another role.
Oh! Damn! Yeah. That's why you haunted flights. Can I still get that role?
So,
are y'all still filming?
Ghost Part 2. I'm a shoo-in. Get it, shoo-in. Everything was mixed in that, Marcus. Did you learn?
I saw the connecting of the dots.
Is it just me, or did that like sound like the beginning of like an Alanis Morissette song? Like, I'm a plane.
Isn't it ironic? It's like a shoe.
But like, how whack does it have to be, though?
Right.
That's whack, man, to like die before your dream is like realized.
Yeah, and you know what was really ironic is the part that she was cast for, the character actually killed herself.
Oh my God, that's crazy.
Just load it in there with all sorts of irony. So yeah. So
that's a movie right there.
That is. So Shana, what claims do they have up there?
there
like
you
that?
You
sound like a professional there.
Glad you asked.
I'm learning.
I see it.
Are you listening, TLC?
We got a guest investigator.
We got a guest
investigator.
Can you imagine?
We got a guest hunter.
Only if you take Stephanie with you.
Oh, we take everybody. Yes. Right,
we taking Stephanie.
Does she? Stephanie would be in first class and I'd be in coach. That's
so you guys are taking her.
We'll all be in coach then.
Yeah, we're all there.
So the claims there, there are a lot of hiking trails around the Hollywood sign. You used to actually be able to hike up to it, which you no longer can. There's tons of security.
Some people sneak
alarms.
And still do it, but yeah.
They do, but there's actually a lot of alarms here. So that's one of the things, is that the park rangers report that the alarms are tripped all the time, and there is nothing, no animals, no people, nothing that's actually tripping the alarms. We've also had park rangers say that they've encountered her. They encounter this blonde woman with blue eyes and with a really strong scent of gardenia perfume. And when they try and approach her, she disappears or fades away. Or that we've had hikers that have gone and said that their dogs have started to get really afraid and tried to back away as this woman that kind of looked drunk, a little lost, was kind of wandering around. So when they tried to approach her, tried to get away from her because they thought she was drunk, she would just fade away. So she is seen, but more commonly, it's also the smell of her gardenia perfume.
So
which is very prominent at that time, by the way.
Now, that's a real good catch when you can, that's gardenia.
meatloaf.
You get the smell of meatloaf, it's all over.
It's all over.
You know, I've never been so excited to make meatloaf and wear pasties at the same time.
Oh my gosh, you keep saying
that. You're going to have some very happy gentlemen.
You ain't been so excited.
And some ladies, too. Some very happy ladies, too.
Keep teasing Dalen and us.
I love meatloaf and I love pasties.
Now, Michael, I know you've been in theaters in New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles, and I've been in theater too. Have you had any haunted theater experiences?
No, but I thought of another story. But
okay.
So I remember being 4 years old, right? And
God, what year was that?
Oh man,
we were in
Hollywood Land was still up.
It was when the talkies started. And so I remember, for some odd reason, my parents had a couch in front of a closet. The living room couch was in front of this closet.
To keep you in the closet. Boom! Oh. It's Mark has been in the room.
I see you're on.
It was so I couldn't go back in.
Right.
They
were proud.
I was four.
You're gonna. We already know, baby. We already know.
The doctor was like, "Oh, hello. It's a gay."
Boom. Hello, mother.
Meatloaf.
I love it, babe.
Okay. Anyway, so I'm on the. I remember laying on the couch and my mom having some like fresh, warm laundry, and I'm just you know, warm laundry. And,
yeah.
So I'm laying near it, and I remember my hand sort of being tugged.
Word.
Underneath. Well, I'm on the couch.
Yeah.
Underneath the laundry, and I just remember just this little pool.
That's like some Conjuring Part 3 stuff.
Yeah, I can't do that stuff.
Right.
I'll be like, all right, don't touch me now. I didn't touch you. You didn't touch me. Right. Come on.
But I don't remember being. I don't know if it was because I was four, but I don't remember being really freaked out about it. It was just like, oh, no.
Wow. Well, and as a kid, I mean, as those kids, you know, kids.
Kids and pets are more
open.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
So.
Like. Oogly, when you guys were with that cat was like the number one paranormal.
Hey, that cat might have been one of the paranormal. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That might have been. That
what if there was never any Oogly? Like, that would be
crazy. Exactly. Oogly
had said that.
Yeah, we were like, what if this isn't really Oogly? Or nobody can really see Oogly but us.
I didn't see any cat food. I didn't see any, like,
we
kitty
didn't
litter
see any
anything.
Cat food. No. We didn't see any cat
Oogly
food.
Oogly goes and gets his own cat food. Right. It seems like it's like
that
like,
cat was cool. He was like calling Pizza Hut. He was like, "Yeah, I'm at the haunted house.
You know where
just
I'm
leave
at?
It. It's Meow. Fine. Yeah.
Back door.
The car is set in."
As we get down to business, because now we're going to get down to the nitty nitty gritty of the Ghost Brothers, who they are, how they work, how they met, and their fashion. By the way. We have to thank our sponsors. First of all, Test Loop, which is the only way to travel from LA to Palm Springs or Vegas. It's the best service. It's affordable. You're in your own Tesla. You're in your own space pod. It is the best. And like I said, it's a lot more affordable than you think. Go to testloop.com to find out more. Spunk Loop. Spunk Loop is our tried and true. they're on many LA sets. Excuse me, gentlemen. It's for every type of audience.
I vouch for
paranormal.
Wait,
yes.
Are you vouching for,
yes.
Are you vouching for every audience?
No, it's a number one award winner.
No, he's vouching for the product.
Okay.
Spunk Lube. A little dab will do you.
It works.
A little
yes.
dab.
Okay. Hey.
A little dab.
If your machinery, you know, when you guys are doing it and it gets a little rusty, and you're good. Spirits be moving.
That's funny.
But we love Spunk Lube.
Spunk Lube.
Gay, straight, in between, it works for everybody.
Lube for all locations.
In between.
Also, a favorite sponsor of ours is Hooch App. Of course, Hooch, you buy one drink per month and they give you 30 free drinks.
What?
Yes, it's the best app and it's in all major cities. So you pay, it's like $9.95 a month, and then every day they send you a free drink at some different bar near you.
Oh,
it's amazing.
So you can't get all 30 in one bar?
No. Or the same night. No.
I got my app. I got my app. God dog it.
Hooch app.
Hooch. Hell.
But it's great. You can get drunk 30 days and pay for one. And they've given On the Rocks a code word so you can download it for your first month for $1. Uh-oh, gives you 30 days of drinks. Just put in code word turnt up. TURNTUP. They thought about it, me.
Is that because the Ghost Brothers are here that they use the term turnt up?
Well, we've had it for a while.
Okay, I'm just making sure.
They've seen me on a Friday night. That was
turnt.
They were like, can you turnt up? Turn it down.
Turn it down.
Of course, Panache Optical Gallery, they do all of the celebrity sunglassware, eyeglassware. They have a showroom in Palm Springs and Guerneville. They just sent me these new glasses. These are actually made from records, from vinyl records.
Oh, those are cute.
Yeah.
Got
to put them on. Let us see.
Yeah, they're amazing.
You can't see. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, those are hard.
Yeah. I think they look better on me. Actually.
I was going to ask you if you can pass them around the table.
Yeah. Actually, contact them. Better. Contact Panache. Tell them On the Rock sent you. They make frames in your style. They do retro. They do aviator. They do James Bond style. They fit the lenses. Everything is custom. And so this is actually made from a record. And you can see some of the scratches from the record. And then your glass case is actually the record thing that it came in.
That's really cute.
So everything is custom. It's so great. I talked to the creator, and he's some crazy guy, but they do some really good work. So contact Panache Optical Gallery. They're on Facebook. And, of course, our media sponsors, Hillcrest Social, they stream us on their app, and it is the app for San Diego. Oh.
The outfit is complete.
I think I just lost. I just lost a pair of glasses.
It is what it is, baby. You know, you start talking in riddles when you got fly glasses on. It is what it is.
That's the OG.
And it's great because it hides from a hangover. It hides your bags because you can see through them like they're kind of regular.
That's dope.
And then, of course, our media sponsor, Bear Cubs and Scruff on Instagram. Take a like. Follow them. They retweet all of our stuff and repost all of our stuff. We love them. You can find us on Twitter and Instagram at On The Rocks On Air, Facebook, On The Rocks Radio Show. You can book me at weddings, funerals, quinceañeras, brisses, whatever. I'll be there. Send an email to info@ontherocksradioshow.com. And now on to our guest. I'm so excited. Before we get started, to acclimate our listeners to who Ghost Brothers are, we're going to play the trailer for season two. It's just premiered on TLC Friday nights at 10 p.m., 9 p.m. Central. Let's play the trailer. Let's get it on.
Let's get it.
That sounded weird. Yeah. Sorry.
Meatloaf.
There's a lot of people in this room.
Advertised spunk junk.
Are ghosts for real? And
why is everybody still white?
Brothers in the place.
Wow.
All the crew can face the fear.
Is anyone in here with us?
I'm Dalen, the leader of the group. We're three best friends who all had paranormal experiences as kids. Now that we're grown, we're not afraid to look for answers.
Right there. It just came out.
Doors are just randomly slamming in here, bruh.
Did he just take his shirt off?
Make sure you don't catch any spiritually transmitted diseases.
I'm Juwan, and I'm a ghost brother.
This is the old rule. One black person, scary, all scary.
My name is Marcus, and I'm a ghost brother.
Did it say get out? Is that what it's saying?
Our mission is to hit the most haunted locations in America to prove that ghosts are for real.
What?
Wow.
Ghost brothers.
I'm so in love. By day, Dalen and Juwan are fashion designers with their own label called Dalen Spratt. Their clothes, we have a few pictures, are gorgeous. Though in their off time, they have been investigating haunted houses, hotels, and cemeteries together since 2011. Marcus, a comedian and barber to the stars, met Dalen in 2009, and now, as an experienced ghost hunter, he considers himself the Peter Venkman of the trio. Yes. Ghost Brothers, welcome to On the Rocks.
What's up? Let's be here.
Oh, we get a round
Thank
of applause.
Thank you, crowd.
Yes.
Thank you, crowd.
It's all the spirits
in here. Calm down.
Everybody calm down. It's all right.
I have so many questions for you guys. Number one, like how good friends are you? Because according to the show, you guys have the best chemistry. You guys read each other's patterns, and the humor is what I love so much. There's a lot of ghost shows out there. This one really captures the men behind the paranormal investigation. Like, you guys are like, you're like every man able to do this. And like, it's fun, it's funny, and it's informative. How close are you guys friends?
Man, I would say that we are actually very, very good friends. I know a lot of TV shows, man, they put a cast together.
Yes.
But literally, like, we've been broke together. Yeah. Like, we also about sharing rides.
That was yesterday. That was yesterday.
Sharing rides together.
We spent that destination
and I stayed in a studio. TLC check. We used to live in a studio apartment.
Like, this is real life.
The three of you lived
friendship.
In a studio?
No, not three.
I couldn't fit in there.
Right.
Back in the day, I was like,
but with that ego, nobody would fit in there. Like, let's get a three-bedroom up in here and one for my hat.
Right. Right.
No, we're like really best friends.
Genuine relationships, man.
And you guys have that clothing line, and it's beautiful tailored suits, and it's been featured in Entertainment Weekly. It's been featured on so many celebrities.
Correct.
How did the fashion design get?
Yeah, it's funny, man. So like back in 2007, I believe I studied abroad in Beijing, China. And then when I was there, I've learned the logistics behind manufacturing.
It's crazy,
right? So when I came back to the U.S., you know, me and Juwan were talking, and we were just trying to figure out like what we were gonna do after college. And we decided like we wanted to be entrepreneurs. Like, I mean, we were actually studying to go to law school together, and we were at Georgia.
Yeah. Can you guys imagine you in a courtroom? Yeah. That'd be like another show, like a spinoff of Ghost
Law
Brothers.
Brothers yeah. in the Law Brothers.
Law Brothers in the
place. Objection, my man.
Your Honor. Your Honor.
Your Honor. But we don't fuck with that.
Man, it's, you're right. It's crazy. We were actually at Georgia State sitting in a law prep class, and we looked at each other, and we were just like, bro, we're tired of going to school, man. And we was like, look, if we get up and leave right now, we have to promise each other we're going to make something happen. And we literally shook hands, got up in the middle class, and walked out.
Now, that takes some balls.
Yeah.
So tell me, all three of you, tell me a bit of your background, because I know, Marcus, you're in comedy, which takes a whole different set of balls to like be in front of people and be funny and all that. Where do you get your strength from your past? Were you always like this as kids? Is it from your family? Is it from...
Yeah. I would say that I actually put up a post today on The Marcus Harvey on Instagram.
Yes. But, how you did that.
See, yeah. I did that smooth in there. Yeah. But I put up a post today thinking about that.
Wearing pasties.
Wearing pasties and meatloaf.
Boom. That's why he was late. He's like, oh, gotta take it off. Okay. Ow, ow.
Okay, it's off. I'm ready. Call the Uber. You know what I'm saying? So, but no, I mean, I was saying this to a lot of people, and this is just to everybody in this room. You all know that y'all were special when you were growing up. Like, there's never been a time
where I was on a short bus. Yep.
Hey, listen, I was on the shorter bus. It was only just me and my mom. She put me in the backseat.
It's like, the minivan.
It's the minivan. Like, but she made it yellow. She's like, I know what I got in the backseat. She said, I know what I got in the backseat. He is special. So, no, real talk, though. Like, I think that we all know that we're special, and I think that we just found out a way to kind of, like, step out on that courage to believe that we're special and actually – do something about it. You know what I'm saying? Like them walking out that classroom, you know, me walking out of my my comfort zone and joining them. You know, it's just been one of those things that, and it continues to be one of those things where you don't really give credence to fear. You just allow yourself to kind of push through. You know what I'm saying? So
now, Juwan, we have a picture of you from Boy Scouts.
Oh, yeah.
There
it is.
There we go.
Throwback.
This was pre-modeling days. Yes.
Oh, man, that's pre a lot of things.
Is this where you learned your strength was from the Boy Scouts? You learned how to tie a knot, that's for sure.
Still a virgin in that picture.
Oh, man, I think I was fresh off.
Yes, Juwan, no.
But was he, though? Because you know the Boy Scouts.
Yeah. He's got game, by the way. He's got fans from both sides of the track, if you know what I mean.
There it is. Hey, the text above the group.
If you look closely, there's a special kind of patch on his. He's like, virgin no more.
Y'all are funny.
The draws.
How you doing? It's called GTD, Tommy.
Got the draws.
Got the draws.
Sponsored by the day after pill.
Right. Plan B.
72 hours.
Make a decision.
Spunk
baby.
Lube.
Make a decision. Spunk
there you
lube.
Go.
So I have a question for you guys. Lord. I first want to say I watch your show, Lord. And I have to say I am such a fan because most of these shows I find are pretty boring. And as an investigator, I know that investigations are a lot like fishing. Sometimes you get a lot of bites. Sometimes you get nothing.
Yeah.
So I love that you guys have been able to create this show that I can watch and be very entertained. I love the humor in it.
Love
but
it.
That doesn't take away from the investigation techniques. Right. You present it in a very accurate way. So as an investigator, I really appreciate that. You guys are awesome.
That's dope, man.
Yo, that is so dope. Go ahead.
No, it's just kind of like we take investigating serious, but we don't take ourselves seriously, right? And I think that comes off because we can joke around and everything. And I think we always strive to find that sweet spot of humor and earnestness, right? Not try to come off corny, still offer some facts, but offer some laughter, and it works sometimes.
And you're also appreciating the audience. You have an audience that's watching the show for an hour, you know, and if there's not a lot of stuff happening, like, you guys have to fill it. You guys are entertainers. You have a TV show, and I think it's a lot of respect to the audience. You're like, well, we're going to make you laugh a few times, too.
Yeah.
I mean, and I tell you, it's a good mix, because I'm laughing, and then I'm scared out of my pants for the next second.
I'm going to be honest with you, we're laughing to keep from crying, though. Like, we make ourselves laugh to get through those investigations.
And that's
like,
so important. It's so important to have that humor part to cut some of that seriousness,
and
right?
And you're an investigator, and you know yourself, like, your crew, when you go out and investigate, none of y'all are just, like, super surreal, you know, and just, like,
we're all investigation. Like,
and you're with your friends.
You're with your friends.
But a lot of people, even on TV, they take that role. It's like, I'm a paranormal investigator. It's like, you're a human, too. And they take all the fun out of it.
And their shirts are too tight.
Yeah, and they don't have a badge.
Well, Juwan wears shirt, tight shirts,
tight
too.
Shirts is
this coming from the man in shoes that wouldn't step in mud.
That's not always a bad thing.
Right.
But I really appreciate it. You guys are able to create this show that I can watch without getting bored, without wanting to walk away. But it's still something where I'm watching and I'm not like yelling at my screen that you guys are being inaccurate. You're being very accurate and giving different facts. Like, I loved when you guys actually addressed that voodoo is actually your religion.
Right.
You do your research with it. So yes. I love that. So my question for you is, especially since a lot of other TV shows misrepresent what we're really about, what advice do you have to give somebody that's maybe an inspiring investigator that's watched your show that wants to follow in your footsteps?
Man, I tell people all the time, people write us messages all the time asking a similar question, and I tell them, you just go out there and do what you feel is right. There's no right or wrong when investigating. Like, everyone has different techniques. The same way like a detective that goes out and solves a criminal case, everyone has different things that work for them. You can't look at this person and be like, oh, I'm gonna take that style. No, they do what feels right. Go out there, ask questions. If you're joking, if you're a jokester, be a jokester. If you're serious, be serious. Be who you are. And I take it that the spirits can recognize, you know, they say real recognize real.
Yep.
Yeah. So
or dead recognize life.
So we bring
dead recognize live.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Bring
exactly
life
like
to
that.
The
yeah.
dead.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Bringing life to the dead.
So just be yourself, man. And then I think everything works out that way. I think, you know, like they say, animals can mm-hmm. sense fear and stuff like that. I feel like spirits can too, man. So just be yourself.
Are there any moments where it's like, this is not funny?
No,
like,
no.
You're like, all the humor is just so like, when, I can't even, you know, overcome it when, by being, you know,
when
the
you're
humor.
Laughing, we're terrified.
Right.
There's like every time you guys are laughing, we're in our terrified moment. And Juwan,
I'm gonna give you a prime example.
Prime example.
This last episode, right? Dalen and I, when Marcus put the clown on top of the stairs.
That was
Dalen and I already deal breaker. You said clown. I'm done.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'm done. No,
so, that was a crazy moment because I was like, what do I do now?
My words were, if I go around that corner, you won't ever see me again.
Yes,
like that's a legit.
But you feel it.
Yeah, and I'm like, there's no way I would really go around.
And
that
there's
corner
nobody ahead of you filming you back.
No,
it's like, okay, we'll see ya.
Yeah, like it's like, nope. I don't even know what's
going
to happen.
And people don't realize, like, when you're in situations like that, you start thinking of every horror movie
you've ever
watched.
Don't go upstairs.
Exactly.
Don't go upstairs. And there you guys are going upstairs. Exactly. With the missing stair by. Even Oogly wouldn't go up
there.
Hey,
he
said,
like,
he said,
meow.
If Oogly don't go up there, we're not going up. Oogly did this. All right. Yeah. Oh, no.
Yes, I think Oogly plays for my team, by the way. He was a little like, go ahead, guys. Let's see what happens to you guys. Right. Yeah.
You guys have that upstairs, if you will. But no, I think that, I really think that that's something that we try to maintain. It's just like that realness, you know what I'm saying? Like, if it is somebody who's just starting, like, I think it's like this. All the ghosts that we investigate used to be alive. So if you think about it from this perspective, if I came up to you and I was somebody totally different, aggressive, I was like, you're going to give me answers. You're going to give me answers now. You're going to like, I'll just fly away. I'll just float away. Versus like with us, you know, we're very cordial. We're very, you know, personable. We actually know the investigation. We know the
you
story.
You guys do a lot of
it.
Research.
We make sure that we respect whatever spirit or whatever we're investigating. Typically, we find something that's a strong story, you know, to go at. So we'll typically be very cordial to those people.
You even dress like them with the visual.
Yeah, visual provoking. And that's one of those things
there
that
we
try
to do. There was some style going on there.
And he was fresh. Hey, he was dipped.
He was casket fresh.
That boy was dipped.
He
was casket fresh.
A little cross promotion, man.
Yes, never heard anybody. Right. He made it look good. I'm like,
casket fresh, man. So yeah, like, and I think that that's just something that we kind of do. It's just like, we bring the innocence of curiosity as well as like trying to learn on the fly. Because like, to be honest, anybody who says they're an expert, you still have to kind of like, you're still going off of like what you feel, most of your emotions. Like, how do we know that this, you know, this SLS cam really works? I mean, we're just going off of real feel and like just made it technology.
Because with any expert, really, like the education never ends. You don't want to go to a doctor that hasn't picked up a book in 20 years. So there's always something new to experience. But on the topic of you guys respecting spirits, I have to say that was another thing that I was my observation watching you guys was that you guys are incredibly respectful. And that's something that I do feel that I don't really see demonstrated a lot. Mm-hmm. So that was, I think, and I think that's one of the reasons why you guys seem to get so much evidence. Like, you guys have so much.
Yeah.
You
and
guys
I think
do
part
have a lot
of
it
evidence. Is your manners. I've watched you sit there and apologize for the spirits for cussing. And like, that's great.
And you play with them. And as we know, even from Stephanie, spirits are are very playful. And it could be that they're so bored haunting the same place that nobody really goes to
anymore.
Ain't
nobody got no cable in those houses.
Yeah, it's like, what am I doing?
There's no Wi-Fi. The Instagram just keeps having that little reloading.
Bro, that's the worst.
That loading thing right there, you just keep trying to pull it down and that joint just keep doing it. Oh, my gosh. Somebody please come investigate my home. I'm out here on my Instagram ghostness.
And the owner of the home is like, I got to pay rent. Please, TLC, come film. Pay the location fee. Let's do this.
For everybody.
Yes. What I also love from the premiere episode of season two, TLC, Friday Nights, was that the spirits were kind of fighting each other because there were two spirits that had a history together. One was the bad guy, one was the good guy, and they fought each other. We never kind of think of that. We think of one spirit overlording something, but we forget that there's so many different layers.
Ghost on ghost violence, man.
Yeah.
We're really out here trying to
start a nonprofit, Marcus.
We actually are starting. It is ghost on ghost violence, ghost care, ghost lives matter.
Hey, right. Ghost lives matter.
Ghost
lives.
Ghost care.
Love it.
I dig it. I can volunteer for that one. I dig that. So I do have a question for you guys about the respect that you guys do give spirits, because again, I was really taken back. I was very impressed by that. So a lot of times we see people go into investigations and it's because we want to prove that spirits are real, that this is a thing, these people that are experiencing it aren't crazy. But after the investigation ends, we don't normally see what happens. So where do you guys take it? After investigation ends, do you guys help educate the homeowners or the business owners about what's going on and how to deal with it? Do you guys help try and figure out how to cross the spirits over? What's your thoughts on that?
Man, listen. Go ahead.
Address
you want me to address?
No, you got it.
And
I'll piggyback.
Okay,
on
it's a teamwork.
Yeah,
number one, who said that Dalen was the leader? Because in all the bios I got and everything I look at, Dalen's the leader.
I know, right? Man, listen, man. Somebody
he's on Wikipedia. He's updating it every night.
That's actually me typing that in there, like leader,
president.
you just catch it right before it gets edited, right? Like right before they change it.
He slips a 20 to that, and everybody's gonna like,
"Don't worry about that,
King Ghost." It sounds better, guys.
He actually goes in there and be like, yep, it's only one member, Dalen Spratt. whoa, you're going solo already.
And the Temptations.
It's like Ghost Brother and then S is in like little.
Yeah, in parentheses.
Right. But no, I think what's strong about our show is that we don't profess to know everything.
That's what I loved about it. You went to see if it was haunted. You didn't go to cleanse. Yeah, you didn't go to do whatever. Yeah. And then you guys peaced out. When they said hell, you guys peaced out.
Man, we talked to the owners of these places. We try to, you know, see if they need anything. But, like, we are praying for them. Like,
yeah, man, I pray for y'all.
We'll put some gas in
send me a postcard.
Thank you. We bless your name that Frank is still in this building. Can he come home soon, God? Let him come to heaven. Okay,
no.
We can't do nothing for you, Frank.
It's against the Lord's will. Yeah, like I said, we're still learning this too. So with every episode that we, you know, every location we go to, every season that we have, we're learning. We're asking questions ourselves. Like, we don't know. You know what I mean? We're trying to figure it out. Yeah. Can you help cross someone over? Like, what happens on the other side? Like, we're trying to figure it out. And that's what's cool about our show, that you get to figure it out along with us.
Yeah. We really do leave the owner with, hey, we thought it was haunted, bro.
You're right.
You might not want to stay here. I'm gonna be honest with you. Like, yeah, that's how we leave it.
And then you know, it's dope that you know you can kind of like we're gonna be able to have room to grow. You know what I'm saying? Like maybe season 4 or 5, we actually might know that practice to be like.
But I think that's what you're talking about. The audience, we feel like we're on a journey with you.
Yeah.
It's not like somebody trying to teach us this is what happens and I live in this kind of life and whatever. We're on the journey with you. We're every man with you.
Yeah, it's absolutely something where I feel like I'm there in the investigation with you guys. I'm connecting to the experience in such a real way. It feels wonderful to watch you guys explore this in such a way where, again, it's so rich in history. And again, I love your investigation techniques. You present it in a really real way that I really appreciate.
That's dope.
The only thing I have a little question on is how you guys pick your third parties that come in, because Miss Blondie comes in and Marcus, you head off with Miss Blondie.
Yeah, he did.
Hey, I'm just gonna say this.
And she was not like ugly. She's not like, you know.
I'm gonna say this though. I'm gonna say
he
this.
Went off with her.
If you guys notice, it seemed like
there was something going on.
A segment of Get Out. You know what I'm saying? Y'all, if y'all all seen Get Out.
I saw it last week.
We were in a sunken place. White women.
Two. What else?
My homeboy's calling me on the phone. Yeah, three. That's three things.
But
right
I feel
there.
Like the three of you are like looking at who do we partner with, and you're looking at headshots and not their resume.
No.
That's what I'm thinking. Lorraine Warren, no.
No, we actually do have a lot. We've had a couple of episodes where we've had our friends. One is coming up, our homegirl.
Akeisha
came up, and Jason was on the first season, but third season, we are looking to do a little bit more people that we actually know. I mean, most of the times these people are people who've already investigated the home.
So right. That's what I appreciate. Right. Like, yeah. She had been in the home. She knew what was going on. I mean, when the minute she walked in, it turned to that whole hell thing. I was like, I thought it was just regarding her hair color. But no, it was like a whole thing going on.
Man. Wendy, we love your hair color.
I'm teasing.
Hey, Wendy was
I'm just
so
jealous.
Sweet, yeah,
yes.
But you coming out next year, so it's all
yeah,
good.
Right, yeah, right,
you're
right.
On
imagine
it.
Twice. Like, coming out twice.
Hello, sir. Yeah. Let's go to Liberace's home. That's where I'll be home. Yes.
That'd be amazing. That'd be dope.
But no, we really do. We really do like bringing out guest investigators, and we like bringing out women as well because we're all men, right? So you can offer a different perspective.
And I wanted to ask this, Shana, you know, female investigators, it seems like it's saturated, like TV especially, with the paranormal shows at least have a male main figure, and then like the woman is always like the co-star or like Charlie's Angels. In the paranormal investigation world, is there sexism as...
Absolutely, they're absolutely because we're dealing with people that were once upon a time alive. We're dealing with sexist. We're dealing with racist. We're dealing with everything. So depending on how mixed your team is, you're going to get a lot more responses. I loved it when I was able to go to places that were notoriously haunted by children, and I was able to bring people that were mothers there. And I'm like, hey, so can you talk to the spirits? You're a mom. They're going to connect with you more, and they actually did. So we have to kind of cater to the spirits as a fragment of a person, and that person still has all the hangups of all of the people that were alive that are alive today, whether you're very intelligent, ignorant, and everything in between.
I love that. And also, like, what you guys say at the beginning is, like, why are all the ghosts, you know, white? We always focus on the white ghost when there's ghosts from all of our different stories
we're
in American
to
history.
Segregate the paranormal, you know, desegregated. Yeah,
you're trying to take us.
I want only black. No, I'm right.
You're trying to build a wall.
Hey, but that's like, but
and Mexico is paying for it.
Paranormal wall.
Yeah, right.
Meanwhile, 20 years later.
Yeah,
but that is true. Like, we tend to focus on the same ghost stories, and what I loved about the premiere of your show is that it's a family story about murder in a family dynamic at a certain time when it was a cultural difference, it was an economic difference, like a lot of stuff was going on.
And the amazing thing about that story, just some more back stuff about that story, was that family was actually like one of the first black families to actually have land. Yeah. And the people that actually previously owned their family actually loved them so much that they actually willed that land, that piece of land that we were on, and many other acres to that family. So it was like the guy who what was it? Big Reuben.
Reuben.
We called him Big Reuben. We always give our ghosts some, you know, nicknames. So Big Rube, you know, he actually was like really high in the society, not just with the African Americans, but with all the whole like Indiana. And it was just amazing to see that like someone who was like a hierarchy, like killed by somebody who was in his family who was already married into his family, trying to, you know, kill somebody because he raped his daughter. So it's just a lot of different
dimensions to it.
So that's why you had that beef downstairs in the basement.
They didn't, but the crazy thing is, like, nobody saw the evidence that we caught with Wendy.
Yeah.
So it was like, because not all the evidence makes it, right?
Of course.
Because you got to cut down literally a week worth of shooting.
We had
an
incident where Dalen and I were in the basement with Wendy. And the two anomalies, Reuben and Frank, if you will, it seemed as though they were fighting over Wendy. Like, it was like in the...
Oh,
like,
interesting.
Oh, and it got completely out of hand.
I have a question. In your learning and your experiences, what do you think the motivation? Sound like an actor.
Yes.
What is their motivation? Right. But is it different for each one? Do you think it's them saying, "I'm here. I just want to let you know I'm here,"
or they haven't let
unfinished
go.
Business,
ghost are,
or
ghost are petty.
Yeah.
They're petty people.
So true.
And I know David's got something out of that, but ghosts are petty people. Like, they just can't get that. Like, I mean, most of the cases are like some real wrongful deaths. So it's like, I got to make sure that somebody knows that he killed me. You know what I'm saying? So,
But do you find that it's because it's almost like it's like a fragment of our person, of our personality. So it's like whatever is at strongest point when we die. In this case, a lot of them, like you said, it's wrongful death. So it's just like as they're dying, they're like, I am taking you down with me. That's what happens to linger in this world.
Yeah, yeah. I think there could be a couple different instances because you got to think about it. If you pass away, this is me just thinking, if you pass away abruptly, you know what I mean? And something crazy happens and then you wake up and it's like, it's time for you to make that choice. It's like, do you go to this unknown space that you're unsure about, or do you stay kind of where you're comfortable a little bit? And I think a lot of people may get caught up in that
walking to the light.
You just never. I mean, I don't know, man.
That limbo. Yeah.
But I tell you this: if I go, y'all, I'm gonna stay.
Where would you like us to? Where would you like to be? Like, if you had a choice to stay,
where would I investigate you at?
A strip club.
Word. My kitchen meatloaf. With the pasties and the meatloaf.
Oh, he's at the counter. Right. Hello.
Right. He's at the counter.
Right.
Every time.
I'm working security at the strip club.
Dalen.
He's going in my pocket.
Right.
Now, Dalen, you saw your first aberration when you were about 7 years old.
Yeah, man.
So that's pretty young. Do you remember it vividly?
I remember it like it was yesterday. Man, so long story short, my grandmother lived in this small town in West Texas called McCamey where everyone knew everyone. And there was a really bad domestic dispute that left up, leaving one guy dead. So he ended up shooting his girlfriend, and he shot himself, and he died. She survived. So small town, everyone knew everyone. My grandmother and her friend decided to go to the funeral home to view the body. But they decided to take little old Dalen with him at 7 years old.
Bad grandparenting.
Bad parenting.
Lucas Graham
so
track.
I end up
That's
going.
Funny, as a parent, right there. Right. My kids are
but
going
But they want you to experience
me.
Everything yeah. so that when you get yeah. older, you know how to deal
right.
with it.
So I remember walking into the funeral home, and I see the casket, and I see the gentleman in there wearing a light gray suit, white shirt, skinny black tie.
Coogee down to the socks.
Coogee down to the socks.
Rings and watch.
Wings and watches. And then I remember looking at him. And
Lawrence Pratt. Right. Beginnings. You were like, I'm designing this and experiencing this at the same time.
It's called an epiphany. Might be something to this. And I remember asking my grandmother, like, if he shot himself, like, why does he look good? Like, he looks like normal. And she was like, well, baby, it's just a good funeral home, baby. Like, you know, they do a good job here.
They know how to do here. That. They know how to rest them, baby. Yeah. They know how to rest them.
But my grandmother's friend asked me at 7 years old, had I ever touched a dead body before? At 7 years
okay,
old.
Okay, now that's over the line.
No, this is like, yeah. I've heard this. That's why I said bad parenting.
Right, yeah. Right.
It's a fourth.
So I look at her like, no, this is the type of old lady that used to ask you for a hug, but then when you get close, she'd like pinch you real hard. She was that type of old lady. This lady grabbed
Is she still
hand.
With us?
No,
I don't know. No,
she's still watching
those,
you.
Those type of
My
ladies.
My grandmother's here. I don't know about her friend. Her
those type of ladies are always friend. Alive. Those ladies stay
they
alive
never
to like 112. Yep.
They multiply.
Oh, I'm not dying, baby. Right. I got you.
And they're like on Good Day Today. They're like, my secret is whiskey
right.
and men every day.
Whiskey and cool 100.
Cool.
Marlboro Light.
But no, this lady grabbed my hand at 7 years old and put it on the chest of
oh
this
my
dead
God.
Body.
Damn. That's too much.
Bad parenting.
I remember looking at my grandmother like, you're too old to be having bad influences.
Yeah,
in
you're hanging around the wrong
you
people.
You can't have
yeah.
Miss Keisha come back around right. me no more because Miss Keisha got me touching dead
man,
people.
And I remember it literally the feel of my hand on this dead man's chest. And I remember jacking my hand back. And then that night we went back home and I was sleeping on my grandmother's couch. And I remember waking up in the middle of the night and I looked into the kitchen and in the door frame that same gentleman was standing there.
Oh.
Light gray suit, white shirt, wow. black tie. And he was leaning up against the wall, arm above.
Why'd you touch me?
He was comfortable though. He was like, hey, I've been laying down for the past couple
hey,
hours.
Man, let me holler at you for a second. I got some stuff in the background.
Right. Like, and I remember just screaming, and putting the cover over my head. My grandmother came running out. She pulls the cover off. I was like, what's wrong with you? And I remember looking in the kitchen and it was gone. And to this day, I don't know if it was a dream or if it was a reality, but that memory is just like burned into the back of my brain. Wow.
So with that said, I do have a question. After hearing this and watching your show, I have to ask, at what point did you stop doubting? Like, because you just said, like, maybe it was a dream, maybe it wasn't.
Right.
At what point were you like, oh my God, this just got real. This is a thing.
Man, listen.
And you all have your stories, which has all brought you.
Yeah. We've all had crazy stuff like Juwan running through graveyards.
Yeah,
you know, Marcus's story is more so centered around the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost, come on.
The Holy Spirit?
Right. Yeah. Right.
Well, running around a graveyard sounds like my cardio. So
is that what
it works
is?
For me, yeah.
Yo, I'm not doing it again.
You done with
yeah,
that?
Yeah, I'm chilling.
You done with that.
So dude. I guess I just lost a workout, buddy. Thanks, dude. Thanks.
No, but
you
really.
Stephanie.
And literally, like you were saying, like at what point does it turn for you? Like, okay, this is for real.
Now, I think doing the show.
Yeah.
The show, because
most, so what happens is you get all these instances where it's like, okay, the first time you're like, maybe that was me.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? The first episode
when we first went out. Hungover.
We had a situation in, what was that, in Savannah?
What's that?
Cirilla's Weed House.
Yeah, we did it in Savannah, Georgia.
In Savannah, Georgia. And it was just like the first time I had an experience, I was like, that can't really be. But then after that, you know, it's just consistently happened. So, I mean.
I think that change for me was probably, all right, so the first instance is when you meet other people and they have similar stories, right? So then it's like, okay, I can't be crazy. Because you have these instances, but you don't want to share with anybody because they may label you crazy.
Right.
Like, that's how you end up in a straitjacket talking all this stuff.
Yep.
And then you meet these, and I meet them, and they're like, yo, I had instances too. I'm like, oh, okay, cool. So let's group together. Now we're a group. And then when all three of us have something that happens together, like, for instance, where are we at? This episode, we caught a shadow figure.
Oh, yeah, that was Old City. A lot of stuff happened in the Old City Jail in Charleston, South Carolina.
Which is still in the hood.
Yeah.
They got an old prison.
Haunted prison.
A haunted prison in the projects of South Carolina. See how they do us?
It's mental.
It's just
when
weird.
When do I take you guys to haunted prisons in L.A.? Because I'm really excited about hosting.
I see you're trying to get us out for real.
Yeah, let's go.
There's no coverage, literally. Like, Southern California is from the missions, you know, from everything. There's so much stuff.
Don't give away our secrets. Well, I'm trying to lure them over here.
Okay. You already got Dalen. Meatloaf and tassels.
Hey, meatloaf and pasties, bro. Pasties?
Okay, so I will make you guys meatloaf. Okay. I will wear pasties during the investigation. Oh. When are we doing this?
Hey, what time? You said
what time is it?
I'll mix the drinks.
We start at 3. We start now.
When does the sun set? Hold on.
Right.
Now, the truck on these girls.
On a personal level, I want to talk about the entertainment fields that you guys come from. Yeah. Dalen, you know, from your past, in fact, we have a picture from it. You were on a reality show. You were on a reality show. No, I want to work for Diddy. And you were like a contestant on this show.
I should have won.
I used to watch that show. Lie to you not. I used to watch this show. And I saw Dalen, and I swear to God, I told my wife this. Me and my wife were watching the show, and I was like, I'm going to cut Buddy's hair one day. And 6 years later, swear to God, I started cutting his hair.
Yeah.
And there he is. There it is. Go back. Bow tie.
That was my shining moment right there.
There we go.
There it won. Is. I won that one.
He used to call me when he was on the show. Like, he would call me, and we'd, like, talk strategy.
But that's crazy, man. That's looking back at that, man, that was so long ago. Like, my mind frame was so different. That's back when we were heavy into business. My mind frame back then, it was never to get on TV.
Right.
It was to actually work with Diddy. I didn't realize how TV worked back then. Like, I didn't realize that this is like...
You make a phone call?
Yeah.
A phone call for him and then be fired.
Exactly. Like, nobody's really going to be working for Diddy. Like, I thought it was really like, he's going to see your skill set, and you're going to work for Bad Boy, and then you can rise up the ranks. Nah, it's generally about ratings and TV, man. So, yeah, that wasn't just the best of experiences in that regard, but it was dope to be on TV, man. Like, you know, that was right when social media was cracking.
Yes.
Yeah. So this I was famous. I was Facebook famous.
Yeah. I was like, hey, man, Dalen need to win.
Right.
I was trolling on Twitter for Dalen. Like, I was like, when anybody said anything crazy.
I swear to God, I was like, Dalen need to win. And then he lost. I was like,
And Marcus, you come from a huge comedy background.
Yeah.
And on top of that, you cut celebrity.
Yeah, everybody, man. I cut up. Actually,
man,
this,
is that,
what was that?
Is that Urkel?
Oh, that is. That is. Yes.
I swear to.
And of course, you know, Urkel took right away. Somebody more famous than me, I got to tag him. Hashtag him. Let's do this.
But no, it's funny, man. I'm actually going to meet Nas after this. I'm actually his barber too, so he's actually recording right now. So.
Oh, you're just gonna go hang out. Yeah.
Yeah. Real talk. Like
me too. I might see you there.
I cut him. I cut Grant Hill, Chris Webber. I do a TV show called Survivor's Remorse. It's on Stars. I'm the barber for that. So
and
I
they mean, wore some of the fashion.
Yeah. The photo shoot. So it's crazy how, like, I call these things called, I call this a success cluster. You know, you always have your friends that are like, you have that.
We have that in West Hollywood, but it's different.
Yeah. And these are my guys.
Meatloaf.
Right. Okay.
Exactly.
Oh, you want a loaf of that meat?
You want a loaf of that meatloaf.
He said he wants a loaf of that meat.
Oh, my.
No, that didn't say that. Okay. But no, it's just amazing to see, like, you know, the things that we do behind the scenes. And it's funny, like, all three of us have been, like, behind the scenes so heavy. Me and Juwan actually worked on that TV show together, which is Survivor's Remorse.
Because I used to do wardrobe for television and film. So, like, I don't even know if that's mentioned anywhere. But
Hey,
like,
bro.
I did.
Hilarious.
There's a million pictures of you. Like, it's like model style, fitting every suit to a T.
I appreciate that.
Like, you can fill a suit like nobody's business.
Man. Hey. Right.
And I mean that with respect, not flirting, but it's like,
no, it's okay. It's okay. Flirt with him. It's okay. It's okay.
But no, but seriously.
Who are you to say it's okay?
Hey, man, I'm your manager.
Totally flirting. No. But, like, there's a certain, like, I mean, look at these suits. Pictures.
Yeah, man,
it's
these
just...
guys, and that's the amazing thing to see, like, these two young men, like, and, like, they're younger than me, like, maybe, like, a few years, but these guys right here are, like, some of the most focused, entrepreneur-based, like, just intelligent brothers, like,
They always are thoughtful in everything that they do. Like, whenever you anywhere with Juwan, like, everybody falls in love with him. Not necessarily because of his stature or his look or whatever. It's just because he's a thoughtful guy. Because
he looks like the black Clark Kent.
That's why he got the glasses on. Dun, 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 dun. But no, it's like real talk. Like, these gentlemen are just like really intense on like being great at whatever they do. And I think that that's something that we've actually brought over to the ghost hunt, you know, ghost hunting, the paranormal. Like, though we got in this, you know, not knowing exactly what we do, we have a lot of people who are like around us who know the paranormal, and we actually like study. Like, we don't even just like, all right, this is a TV show, we're just gonna go in here and just like, you know, just mail it in. We actually like investigate, learn, you know, what's this technique, okay, if we match this and this,
how can we bring our own stuff,
how can we bring our own swag to it, like, and I think that's what speaks so highly of them. Like, you know, it is put in there that he's our leader because this is a concept that came from Dalen, and you know, and this is something that him and Juwan worked on, and then they just brought me in on, and it's just like it's changed our lives, you know, not only just like outside, but actually being able to see our spiritual life come together. Because like now when you get into the paranormal, you have to be spiritually on point. So right. I just want to give these cats crew.
I love this respect that, going on. Appreciate it. Unusual for Hollywood, you know.
But I think that's
from the A,
but
honestly, people always say that about it. It was like, man, you guys, they expect us to be a certain way or stuck up because you're on TV. But you got to realize, man, we've worked from the bottom of the barrel in TV. Like, we've all been PAs before, running, doing errands. So we get this process. So we never look at ourselves above anybody from the PAs on our set. Yeah. Like, we help. We ask to help
we
them.
Pick stuff up. Right.
Like, oh, let us help you carry that. Like, it ain't no talent in this. Like, we all a team. We all
and
a family,
I,
man.
And then, I kick whatever they're picking up. Like, right. No, that's your damn job, you PA. Get out of my face. Where's my coffee? Right.
Now, you guys, other than doing the show, like, you guys are on this press tour. Like, you guys have done the Andy Cohen show. You guys have done so much.
Colbert.
In fact, we have some pictures from the Colbert show. What's it like to have to travel together and on this intense, like, you guys are answering the same questions. When friends travel together and have to be together so much in a different type of schedule, you know, personalities can start to come out. Like, when you guys squabble, how do you guys work it out?
To be honest, I feel like we knew personalities before all of this, right? Yeah. So
you've already had your...
Yeah, we know our touchy
I know Dalen since 2005, right? We pledged together. We pledged Kappa Alpha Psi back at Clark Atlanta University. So it was like we literally knew each other at rock bottom before all of this, right? So then we can enjoy all of this ride together. Yeah. Like, we met Marcus back in 2008, 2009. So you get to meet all these we get our personalities down to a T. Yeah. Like, we know when we don't want to be bothered one another.
And that's
we always just go our separate way. Like, if somebody's not in the mood, they just go to their room. You know what I mean? Like, it's never any.
And I don't take it personal. Yeah. Like, I don't. Like, if I'm going to be honest with you, because I'm more of a social guy, right? So, like, Marcus, he's like, bro, I just need, because he's always traveling. So he's like, man, anytime I can just actually lay my head down, he will. Dalen, he's like, yo, he's a loner.
He's working.
He's a loner. Like, he'll be like, yo, I'm going to go to the room and just knock out a little work or something, man, or I'm just going to chill.
Like, marketing, all that. Like,
whatever.
Like, so he's like the business.
He's like really like an internet marketer. Like, he's just like always been into that, like on it. And I'm like the one who's going to go sell whatever it is we got to go do.
Juwan's the social person, man. He's the face.
We're going to have to mix and mingle. Like, I'm going to go ahead and mix and mingle and we can finesse our next move. So that's how we do it, and we don't really get caught up on the personal feelings, right? Like, I really don't feel like talking to you right now. All right, cool.
Or who's doing what?
Yeah,
that's
or
the
who's
dope
doing
thing.
What, right?
Who's doing what is the dope thing. Like, I mean, I think that a lot of times when you get, like, a cluster of people, like a trio or a group or whatever, everybody wants to do what other person's strength is.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So, like, they know that I do comedy, but these guys are hilarious. So all they do is just throw me oops just to hear me just
It's so
joke.
Easy, though, bro.
You know what I'm saying? Like, but, like, anytime I have an idea business-wise, I'm hitting Dalen up. You know what I'm saying? Anytime, like, today we're doing something like some type of, like, culture thing. Like, all my culture questions
go straight to Juwan.
Like, how do I approach this? How do I order this? How do I do this? How do I do that? And that's just how we kind of, like, keep the game moving. So, like, when everybody knows their role, nobody gets mad, you know, and we could call you out like, hey, dawg, that's my joke. Get your ass off my joke. Get off my joke. Get off my joke. You know what I'm saying? But it'd just be fun. Yeah.
Or even, like, even if, I'm going to be honest, like, even when we started filming, I was never big on, like, being in front of the camera. Like, that was never my thing, right? Like, these guys actually were doing other stuff. Like, he had did Diddy. They had did a TV pilot before. But I was always like, yo, I kind of would really like to do producing. I'm cool with behind the scenes type situation. And, like, they'll have to tell me, like, bro, you got to get out your own way. Yeah. Like, stop it. Like, yeah. Get it together. Snap it back. You know what I'm saying? And I appreciate it. Like, because that's where that comes from friends. You know what I'm saying? So it works out.
Let's take a look at the premiere episode, a little highlight. And when we come back, we're going to find out how well you guys know each other or think that you know each other.
There it is.
All right. Let's take a look. And Oogly is in this one, too.
Oogly.
I play a partner.
On this episode of Ghost Brothers.
What's up? The problem is I would never turn that corner.
You just don't want to know?
Bro, you turn that corner and you never see me again.
Bro, hurry up, dog, because there's nothing.
You move!
Ghost Brothers in a place where no other crew can face the fear. And we in here, the Ghost Brothers.
Oh my God.
Murder is at the root of all evil at the Thornhaven Manor in Newcastle, Indiana.
Whatever's in this house is very aggressive.
There's a whole bunch of bad energy there.
A family is poisoned to cover up a crime. Is this tragic event the cause of menacing paranormal activity? Will the Ghost Brothers be able to draw out the victim?
Please show yourself.
And solve the mystery of who is haunting Thornhaven Manor.
I don't feel comfortable, man.
The Ghost Brothers.
The man who's doing the voiceovers for that.
You guys, I wrote a funny thing.
That okay. The guy who's doing the voiceovers for our Ghost Brothers now, this one I know we made it. This one I know. The brother from First 48 is doing our voiceovers. When we got the quintessential black voice in voiceover Hollywood doing our joint, we done made it.
On this episode of the First 48.
On this moment.
The guy. But here's the note. I was like, can I just do like that narration for one episode? I'll be like, Ghost Brothers are here, you guys.
I would love it.
They're in the heart of West Hollywood, and they're going to find out
Hollywood
everything.
Episode you have
can
to
you
do.
Imagine,
I would
love I'm not it. Can you imagine
episode.
The audience would be like,
if you're not doing it, I'm not doing the episode. Yeah. If I see the episode start off with you not doing the voiceover, then I'm not doing it.
How funny would that be? Like, we're going to find out what Liberace ate for breakfast tonight. If you don't. I'm not drunk. All right, roll it.
You got to come in on that note, too, though.
Right.
That note.
Come in on
10. Yeah, on that note right there, I need you to be high.
Oh, believe me, I'll be high.
Hey,
all right, so we're going to play a really quick game, and then we're going to do last questions. So I want you to point to whoever this applies to. It's going to be really fast, all right?
Loaded questions.
If you guys are out at a bar, who gets more play? Wow. Everybody said Juwan. That wasn't
sure.
even.
But you said out of the bar.
Right.
Include everything.
right. The world.
Juwan. The world.
All right.
God. Dog.
Who was most likely to have a one-night stand? Oh, my God. Juwan, I need your number.
Hey.
Meatloaf.
Meatloaf.
Who was more of a diva on set? Oh, my Lord.
I really want to do one of these.
Oh, it's a mix.
It's Marcus.
That's Dalen. They be setting me up.
Let's see. Who was late today with and came in with a hat?
Listen, hey, Marcus had to get his asthma pump from CVS.
And I didn't have a room, which lets you know that I can't be the diva. That's two weekends in a row, bro. You told you.
Actually, man, you worried about the wrong thing.
This is a little family dispute, guys.
See what you did.
See what you did. You say asthma pump, I want to see what pump that is.
Hey, man, it's all big, baby. It's all big.
Just say meatloaf.
Meatloaf.
Meatloaf. Two pumps out.
That's all I need.
What are you guys going to do without Spunk me loop. Your meatloaf safe word,
I don't know.
Come on.
I want to see it, like, for the next season. Just say
meatloaf. We're going to
drop it. Just real fast. TLC will be like, what the hell is that cut?
I may say it in every interview from now on.
We get scared of like meatloaf.
Who gets scared the most? Wow.
Yeah.
Who is the biggest flirt? Well, I think we know.
Dutch. I think we have that one too.
Oh, I think Dalen's a flirt.
I want to lean this way.
Hey, man, do I flirt?
But I think that comes with the business.
I'm
like you came in here.
I like how you say that.
Because everybody contacts Dalen.
Right, right.
Everybody contacts.
But I think that's
Dalen.
The business of it too. You have to flirt with everybody.
Yeah.
Who never has cash on them?
That's funny. Never keep
you flirt with the girl and you're like
right
buy
Juwan
a
got it
yeah
and then that's how he ends up sleeping with him like that's how it works
who was the worst driver
I'm the best hands
because
I used to be an Uber driver.
Okay,
all through LA I'm the best hands down.
You guys should do Ghost Brothers Uber Drive and then see if the person has like any
ghost stories.
Stuff.
Ghost stories.
Yes.
I like that.
I sold it first.
We came up with that. Really want to do that at a karaoke joint.
Karaoke car.
People are possessed at karaoke. Right. Oh, this is the next question. Who is the most likely to be possessed by a demon spirit?
Probably me, man.
Because he's going to go there.
Because he tries way
too much.
Because
I'm going to take it too much. Come on, dog. We don't got to go that far.
He's coming up with all these ideas. And
come
next
on,
thing you know,
and he does
we
got to
do an exercise on Dalen.
Right.
Or just call Gwen.
Right.
Call his mama. I'm quick to call his mother.
I love that. You guys should have a mom's episode.
Yeah. She's called in.
So my mother and Marcus's wife actually came to Jamaica. Yeah. We're anxious to see if they made the episode. But we did.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
I want that check in there, too.
Exactly.
TLC.
Who drinks the most?
Okay. I guess, yep.
Dude, they're just picking on you.
Or Juwan is just a party animal. Yeah.
Or Juwan.
I think there's
a
new leader in town.
I'm telling y'all, Juwan is the leader, bro.
Exactly.
Who would be the last survivor in a zombie apocalypse?
Shit, Marcus. Hell yeah,
Marcus.
He'd make them laugh. He'd be like, did you hear that one? The zombie would be like, ha ha, and their jaw would fall
Marcus
off.
Marcus is the number one fan
of
The
Walking
Dead.
Like, I watch Walking Dead.
A recap show.
No, I am. I'm coming up one called Black Dead.
But let me ask you this, Marcus. If it came down to Ghost Brothers and Walking Dead, which show?
Why
are
would
picking?
You even do this?
Walking Dead.
Why would you even do this? I love y'all.
You guys
why
should have like a part on one of the episodes.
I would love to.
John, have TLC call AMC.
Bro,
they're only two letters apart. It'll work out.
What? First season, episode 3. I was an extra in the
no
Walking
way.
Dead.
Oh yeah, guys, you heard it here first.
Let me tell you how hype I was.
I was a Latin gang member
in what. This is
like Walking Dead before Walking Dead got Walking Dead.
Yeah, this is Walking Dead when they only had $20. You know what I'm saying? Right. Nobody's really CGI.
He showed up with a pinata. He's like,
right.
Yeah.
I'm in this thing, right?
Yeah. Had a pocket knife on me.
Who would be the first to go in a zombie apocalypse?
Juwan.
Probably me.
That is so funny.
Juwan.
Huh. All right. Who listens to the worst music?
Dalen.
What's the most embarrassing song on your playlist that if we knew, you'd be like, oh, God.
Oh man, but see that's the thing.
I got it.
Go ahead.
I already know. For y'all that don't know, you may have to Google it.
What?
It's called Rain Boots and a Thong.
Rain Boots and a Thong.
That sounds like a brilliant pronunciation. Yeah.
That's my Grindr profile name.
It's called Rain Boots and a Thong.
Rain Boots and a Thong.
I did. I was DJing that during the episode.
I don't know how he had that queued up, but we were all listening. And the crazy thing is, I knew the song. Like, that was
right.
And I didn't know it, man. I'm like,
but it was catchy, though.
Feel good. Like, feel good you don't know it.
So I'm going to find this song and I'm going to create a burlesque act to it. I'm dedicated.
Yes.
Yes.
At your next Tata's.
We need to have like a ghost floating around, like someone in a sheet, right? We'll have Ghost Brothers written across the butt.
Honestly, you can find a video. Like, if
you
got to
get pop the trunk on the
there's
butt.
There's so many crossover opportunities.
On that butt.
Yeah. If you're burlesquing, you got to have like some boy shorts that said like pop the trunk.
Yeah, pop the trunk.
Are you
if I could find a pair that fit.
This is the thing. I'm tagging you guys all on Instagram in it. It's happening.
Fair enough.
I can't wait.
All right. Last questions from our guest co-host.
Okay. So my last question, because I know that there is a lot of weird things that happen during investigating. There's a lot of scary things that challenge our faith in life and religion and everything else. So why do you do it?
Okay. You got it?
Yeah. I think for us, it's just, we grew up in such religious backgrounds, and in doing so, you're always told you really don't ask questions. You know what I mean? You walk
That's
by
exactly
faith
don't
and
question.
Not by sight.
Yes.
So you don't ask questions. And I'm not I get it, but then it's like, as an adult, it's like, why can't you ask
And your family's
questions?
Religious.
Yeah, my mother's a pastor of a church. Right. She's been a pastor for over 20 years. And so, and she taught me that. Like, you ask certain questions, and it's just like, no, baby, you just got to have faith. You got to believe. You got to trust God. That's cool, and I do. But I also have questions, you know what I mean? And so I feel like as an adult, I can go out and seek those answers on my own. And I want to always be seeking knowledge. And when I got my friends with me, shit, I know they got my back, so I'm not in it by myself.
Yeah.
So you feel good about it. But just, stepping out there on your own, man, and asking questions for yourself and getting those true answers.
Yeah. My answer is pretty similar. Like, as a child, I've always been inquisitive. And my mother always, like, pushed me to just, explore that curiosity. There's nothing better than having like an original thought, you know what I mean? And you can never find that unless you go seek it. So she always really instilled that in me. And I mean, I grew up in the church as well, but not my mother wasn't a pastor, but I think that really came from our religious upbringing. So that's kind of where my why comes from, if you will.
Hey, curiosity creates creation. You know what I'm saying? And I think that with us, we wanted to kind of dispel the misnomer that black people aren't adventurers.
But we don't die.
But we don't die. You know what I'm saying? Like, we really show people that you can be out. You can go outside of the box. We're only living on this earth, and the good thing about us being investigators is that we actually get to deal with death every day. So as a result, we actually make ourselves live every day stronger.
I love that point. You know what I'm saying? I really, really do.
So as a result of that, like, I think that with us doing this show, with us being in, you know, in the paranormal, it's indirectly pushed us to live more. So like we take more risk as far as like things that people say don't do, don't ask. And you ask why, and then they have no real answer.
Yeah.
And then you just have to discover on your own, as you've done in yourself.
I feel
as
like
you've done with your show, like this beautiful show, like, you know, you had
thank
to,
you.
You had to investigate yourself. You're like, yo, I'm gonna do my thing. Yeah. Like, I ain't gonna let nobody hold me back. And I think that's something that we continuously push out there. Like, why hold me back? Why not be?
Well, just to that point, the ghost story about Hollywoodland. You know, every person dies. We all die. But unless you do your dream, then we all die without, you know what I mean? It's like, we're that ghost.
And I ain't hunting this world.
The thing is, if that person didn't pursue their dream,
right?
They're going to always question why you're doing yours or you're not going to make yours. So now they're projecting their fears on you. And then you're like,
jealousy, shade, hashtag hate.
And I know you don't have any ill intent or any malice will, but you just don't want me to do it because you didn't do it. You know what I mean?
Like, no, you're a coward at that point.
Michael, do you have any last questions?
You guys have such a great energy and you're a whole lot of fun. I'd like to know, would you like to bring in some Latin flavor to the show?
Because, on one episode, we actually got a Latin ghost.
We did.
How do you know? Did they wear a sombrero?
No, his name was Miguel.
Hola, yo estoy aquí.
He's like, we need that.
And we needed that because I was over there like, oh, but he just killed his teeth. I tried to do the same thing you did, but it was like,
did he say, like, he said, hi, I'm here?
Yeah, he said his name. He introduced himself.
No, what did you just say? Like,
hi, I'm here.
See, I couldn't even do that.
I want to know how ghosts only show up at night. Like, what are they doing during the day? Are they
freaks
sleeping?
Come out at night.
Do they know what daylight savings time is?
They're taking naps. Hello, they need to get their beauty.
Yeah, you know how much energy it takes. You know how much energy it takes to be able to show yourself.
I know how much energy it takes to ghost somebody online. Bye.
Yeah. Oh, that's it. That is
how you block a number.
Block.
Gentlemen, this has been such a fun show. Thank you to my guest co-host. We're going to go around the room, tell our listeners where they can find you.
Hi, I'm Marcus Harvey. You can find me on Instagram or Facebook. Instagram, The Marcus Harvey. Facebook, Marcus Harvey. You can go to my website, The Marcus Harvey. You can go check my business, my barbershop, The Musalayer, MUSALAIR.com. And, you know, check out some of my dope barbers. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Which one?
You can find me
in St. Louis, rolling.
Apparently, at ladies' night, he'll be there.
Hey, pulling.
He'll be across the street for happy hour.
Yeah.
But no, seriously, you can find me on Instagram at Juwan Mass. That's gonna be my first and last name. On Twitter at Juwan Mass. On Facebook, Juwan Mass. You can also look up our clothing line, LorenSpratt.com.
It's beautiful, you guys.
Upscale, made to measure menswear. Please check us out.
Do you guys do like husky sizes?
Yeah, man, I used to be. Hey, bro, I'm super husky. I'm double skinned most times. I'm not big boning. I'm just double skinned.
Just say I won't freeze in the winter. I'm fine.
So let me know when you guys design pasties, okay?
Okay.
I'm making the pasties right now as we speak, though.
Yeah.
All you need some duct tape and some gum.
I'll be your consultant. It's all good.
Let me know about like a husk. I would. Yeah.
Seriously, we can definitely talk about it. Absolutely, because we really do a lot of weddings, and then we do a lot of
gorgeous.
Like, I mean, and then we just do a lot of like suits for everyday occasion. Like, we really just feel like there's a suit for every occasion. Suits are versatile. If a woman in a wedding can say yes to the dress, then why can't a man salute the suit?
Thank you. Nope. Why do grooms always get checked? We have to rent from some other groom.
You don't have to rent
can
at
I
all.
Get
you
my,
can come
yeah.
to Lauren Spratt and get Perfect. Personally fitted.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly. Well, you know, Juwan just gave an awesome plug. So, but for me, you can find me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Everything is Dalen Spratt. So DalenSpratt. And I always talk back. And on Tinder, I always swipe right.
Oh.
It's a numbers game.
The white,
you guys.
So
the
what y'all
right
want to
swipe.
Do?
Is that what they call it? The right
the
swipe.
The right swipe.
The right swipe. It's like my Jesse
Spano. I could have you every week and like we'd be okay.
It's like my Jesse Spano.
I was like,
moment.
Why are you doing this? He was like, bro, it's a numbers game. I was like, man. He was like, but the thing is, he found out that like you can lose swipes. Like you can run out of swipes.
Yeah, that's why I had to pay for the monthly subscription.
Nobody else in America knows that because nobody has done that.
He swipes right.
knows.
All the time. He's like, bro, like,
Tinder's like, wait, somebody's reached out? What do we do now?
I was like, wait, I have to wait 24 hours, bro. I can't swipe
that
anymore.
That countdown, man. That 24-hour countdown sucks, man.
He's like, I can't film today. I have to swipe.
One. Okay, here we go. Oh, I'm already out.
Michael Vega, how can we find out about you and your acting?
On Facebook, Michael Vega, and Twitter and Instagram is Michael Vega Act. So okay. Michael Vega ACT.
Love it.
So you can find me and Stephanie.
Oh, hey girl, she's behaved so well.
We're
gonna take her to West Hollywood literally after this.
Yeah, literally. You told her you're taking her for a drink.
She's getting a tattoo.
Buying her a shot.
Yep.
She likes tequila, in case you're wondering. Ooh. But you can find Stephanie and I on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. www.intuitiveshana.com. Come check us out. We're at Intuitive Shana. Stephanie, I'm hoping you guys will develop some doll pasties for her too. Ooh. So then we can match.
They're gonna work on that right away. There'll be a new tab pulled out
for the lady who needs pasties for her and her doll.
Okay, I'm
and her cat.
You guys,
and her
cat. Okay,
that's a whole.
Hey. Me and Stephanie, we're gonna be investigating our pasties by you guys. I really hope that
that's dope. Glowing the dark pasties. Yeah.
We're going to put Stephanie on the back of Oogly, and we're going to see what happens.
That poor cat. Hasn't he been through enough?
She's a crazy cat lady, guys.
Tony Sweet, thank you for running our boards today.
Thank you,
TLC, for sending the amazing Ghost Brothers. Check them out every Friday night, 10 p.m., 9 p.m. Central, because I guess in Central they party early.
Right.
Yeah. They have to go to bed early. Why Central time? Anyway, thank you so much to our listeners. And again, go apply for that weekend getaway because it's a huge giveaway. TasteOnEllis.com. Press contact. Type in On the Rocks. You're good. We will see you next Tuesday.
This has been On the Rocks with Alexander, every Tuesday at 7 p.m. on Universal Broadcasting Network. Find me on Facebook on the Rocks Radio Show. Tweet me or Instagram me at On the Rocks On Air. See you next Tuesday!